Friends, the eighth memorial lecture that I forgot was V.S. Gaitonde, the great painter. Sumangala Damodaran, I heard her for the first time in a seminar in Nehru Library, which no longer holds such seminars. But at that time, it was still an interesting dynamic forum on IPTA. And I heard her speak on IPTA's music. And then I thought here was a new person we should watch with some interest. So here you are, caught in my net, finally. And we are very grateful that you agreed to give us this memorial lecture called History, Memory, and Emotion in Understanding Music as Politics. This could be as complicated as possible, but there you are. Music is not a simple matter. It's a very complex matter, as most of you perhaps here know. Now, Sumangalaji is a professor of economics, development studies, and popular music studies at Ambedkar University. At that time, you were in JNU, I thought, no? No, you were always in Ambedkar. Gotcha, okay. And she was involved in research and documentation of a forgotten musical tradition, that of the Indian People's Theatre Association from the 1940s to the 50s, and had also performed from the documented repertoire extensively in different parts of the country and abroad. This work has resulted in a book, The Radical Impulse, Music in the Tradition of the IPTA, and an album titled Songs of Protest. She has also collaborated with poets and musicians from South Africa around a project titled Insurrections, which has resulted in three albums. Why don't you also collaborate with protesting poets in India? They are not quite a large number here. We all think we are protesting. She is currently engaged in researching the relationship between music and migration, particularly of women in slavery and servitude across centuries and across vast tracts of the globe that were linked through long-distance trade in commodities and symbolic goods. So there you are, Dr. Sumangala Damodaran. But before you start,
I'm deeply honored to be giving the Kumar Gandharva Memorial Lecture this year, and I really do not know whether I deserve this or not. So I thank Ashok, Vajpeyi ji profusely for this honor, and the Raza Foundation also for this opportunity. Like many others, I've been an ardent listener of Kumar ji's music, and also had the good fortune of listening to him sing live a few months before he passed away. His unusual and enigmatic style of composition and singing has been analyzed from various perspectives. And as I said, I don't think I really have the right to be, you know, analyzing Kumarji's music. There are people here who knew him and who understood his work, for a large part of his life. But I thought I'll just start with a couple of things that have been said about him and then go on to what I have to say. His music, it has been argued, sought to spurn the very concept of the gharana, even while having been trained within the tradition. This is what one of the things that was said about him. Others firmly believe that he was the true classicist, rescuing classical music to its original ethos from the straitjacket of the gharana. As a teacher, he would show his pupils the kirana approach to a note, which is a bit like a single point stroke, and also the Agra approach, which is more a broad brush technique, and then leave it to them to decide how they wanted to interpret it, writes Nikhil Inamdar. Shubha Mudgal writes, Kumar Gandhar crafted a voice that howled like the wind, carried shades of joy, lament, love, and loss, modeling it on the sounds of the folk music that he had introspected on for years. Not so much a result of endless hours of riyaz, but is in fact a much deeper philosophical observation of, like nature, the vagaries of the human mind and heart, and the study of silence, symmetry, and asymmetry. Given the great legacy and the large corpus of music that he left behind, animating debates that center around questions of tradition, the classical, and the folk, and about the nuances of expression, I hope what I have to say will honor his memory. Aj akhaan varish shanu, kiton kabra vichu bol. Please forgive my Punjabi pronunciation. Te aj kitabe ishq da, koi agla varka phol. Today I call you, Varish Shah, speak from inside your grave. And today, turn the book of love's next page. Ik roi si thi Punjab di, tu likh likh mare vain, aj lakhaan tiya ro diya, tenu Varish Shah nu ken. Once one daughter of Punjab cried, and you wrote a saga of sadness. Today, a million daughters cry out to you, Varish Shah. Amrita Pritam wrote this here as a response to the violence, particularly against women, during the partition of India. She addressed it to the 18th century Punjabi poet Varish Shah, who had written the popular version of the love story, Heer Ranjha. The poem, which is sung in the form of the classic Heer, which is said to owe its origins to Varish Shah, appeals to him to rise from his grave, record Punjab's tragedy, and turn over a new page in Punjab's history. A few years before, a young woman, Swatantrata, stood in front of a microphone facing a mass gathering of more than 80,000 peasants in Lahore. She sang a heer which related the story of a young girl from faraway Bengal who lost her home and family to the ravages of a terrible famine, which was the Bengal famine.